The Japan government announces a 17 trillion yen or $113 billion stimulus package to cushion the economic blow from inflation. The package will fund measures including temporary cuts to income and residential taxes, payouts to low-income households, and subsidies to curb gasoline and utility bills. According to government estimates, the combined spending plan of the national and local governments under the package will help boost Japan's GDP by around 1.2% each year for the next 3 years. Japan's inflation, which has remained above the central bank's target of 2% for more than a year now, has weighed on consumption and overall economic growth. Asian markets ended Thursday trade higher as they cheered U.S. Fed Jerome Powell's less-than-hawkish statements. The benchmark MSCI Asia Pacific Index outside Japan surged 1.6%, the biggest daily jump since late July. The South Korean Kospi Index led gains, climbing 1.8%, even as inflation there accelerated for the third straight month in October. Some notable stock movements in the region: shares of SoftBank jumped 1.5% on Thursday. That's after it raised $800 million through Japan's first bond-type share listing. The telecom firm said the money will be used to fund its medium-term plans. Over in Korea, shares of Asiana Airlines and Korean Air back in focus. That's as Asiana announced it would sell its cargo unit, an important step towards allaying EU competition concerns over the proposed takeover by Korean Airlines. Analysts, however, doubt the move will ensure smooth landing for the deal, sending Asiana shares plunging 8.6%. Also bucking the uptrend in the region, DBS Bank. This after Singapore's central bank slapped it with a six-month suspension from making new investments to ensure it focuses on fixing its digital banking services. The bank has been plagued with a series of significant disruptions throughout the year. Here at home, the local bourse remained closed for All Souls Day. But First Metro Investment sees the Philippine Stock Exchange catching up the region's gains on Friday following the Fed's move. She also sees the Philippine Central Bank mirroring the Fed's move when it holds its policy meeting in 2 weeks.
The fact that the U.S. Fed held its key rate steady is going to be favorable. It's a positive step. In as far as there's reduced pressure for the BSP to hike rates further, because I think the off-cycle rate hike was intended to preserve the yield differential between peso asset and U.S. assets. We are now at the key rate of the BSP is now at 6.5, and then in the U.S. is 5.5. So the BSP has stuck to its 100 basis point yield differential between U.S. rates and Philippine rates. I think the BSP will be sounding very hawkish and saying continuously, reminding the market that the more rate hikes are on the table, but not necessarily doing more hiking, but just keeping the tone very hawkish, because it wants to maintain stability in the currency by sending the message that it's very proactive and really vigilant about inflation. Hopefully the market prices in what's happening now in the U.S., that this could be the turning point as far as U.S. Fed hiking is concerned, because Fed Powell is now being viewed as implying that this could be not really the end, but could be nearing the very end. The reaction of the U.S. 10-year rate was to fall. Coming from 5%, that U.S. 10-year treasuries fell to 4.7%. I think that's a good sign.
China agrees to work with the United States, the European Union, and other countries to manage the risks of artificial intelligence. Representatives from 28 countries signed the Bletchley Declaration during the AI Safety Summit hosted by the UK. The document details a two-pronged agenda to identify and better understand the risks of AI. British Prime Minister Rishi Sunak says governments must take action on AI safety since it is too important to be left to tech firms.
You know, we can't expect these companies to mark their own homework. Now, that has to be the responsibility of governments. That's why I've created the AI Safety Institute here in the UK, which I hope can be a globally leading institute to research the safety of these models. But then, as the companies have already done, is give access to the UK to look at these models before they're released, to work with them on that, so that we can do the testing that is necessary to make sure that we are keeping our citizens and everyone at home safe. It has to be governments or external people who do that work.
Meanwhile, U.S. Vice President Kamala Harris calls for urgent action to protect the public from threats posed by AI. She also shared her hopes of creating a global roadmap during the AI summit.
But just as AI has the potential to do profound good, it also has the potential to cause profound harm. From AI-enabled cyber attacks at a scale beyond anything we've seen before, to AI-formulated bioweapons that could endanger the lives of millions of people. These threats are often referred to as the existential threats of AI, because, of course, they could endanger the very existence of humanity. These threats, without question, are profound, and they demand global action.